You planning? You got plans for the weekend yet? No. Okay. Well, I thought you might want to go to the drive-in. The drive-in. Drive-in movie, you know? Can view? No, that's not fake news. It's not fake news. You say, all right. Well, stay tuned to the show and we'll run it down for you. Okay? Okay. Keep your weekend open. All right. Hey, welcome to season 3, episode 40. Nice round number. Of Niagara 411 Live with Lee Sterry, fueled by Gale's Gas Bars, powered by WeeStreem, supported by Verge Insurance Group, and housed in this wonderful pubbery in downtown St. Catharines, Fiddler's Poorhouse. We have a really jam-packed hour and a half here for you today, so we're going to get right to it, and we are going to jump into that, what I was surprised, I guess we could call controversy? Maybe that's too strong a word. But there was a kind of a general announcement, but sort of under the radar, about Can View Drive-In Movie Theater in, what do we call it, Fond Hill, Thorold, St. Catharines, you know, along the 406 there. And it just exploded all over the internet there, and we're going to have a gentleman on that knows probably as much as anybody. He doesn't know everything, but probably as much as anybody about what's going on at the Canview Drive-In Movie Theater. Some other great people coming up on the show for you today. So listen, just hang around for about 30 seconds, and we shall be right back. We are live again, Niagara 411 Live with Lee Sterry, as I said, season 3, episode 40 already. And again, thank you to Gale's Gas Bars for being our title primary sponsor on the program, Verge Insurance as well. Thank you very much. And of course, as per usual, our executive producer is Kevin Jack of WeeStreem. And we're going to, hey, Kevin, how you doing, man?
I'm doing great. Lee, how about yourself?
I'm terrific. Boy, we've had a nice run of weather over
Absolutely. You and I got out golfing last weekend.
Yeah, we did. Well, you golfed. I just kind of walked around. But as far as the election has gone by, we're not going to get into that. I mean, it's old news kind of right now. But I thought that we might have an increased interest and an increased turnout because Monday, Election Day, was an absolutely spectacularly perfect day. So when I went over to vote, I thought, all right, this is good. This is nobody has a weather or mobility excuse caused by Mother Nature or anyone else other than yourself to not vote. But turnouts were still low.
Except Niagara on the Lake, almost 50%. But hey, that's behind
us. Yeah, yeah.
We'll readdress it in 4 years. Lee, we have an incredibly packed show today.
We do. So we're going to
get right into it.
Yeah, we're going to get right to it. As I mentioned when I was talking with my worker there on the phone out on the street, this story just exploded yesterday, and it's because this lady Amanda Sarah Porter put this post up, and what we're on the Pelham News site right now. Canview Drive-In opening under new ownership for informal, or should be an informal, Halloween Scream Screen this weekend. Updated Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. That means that you'll hear more Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. They have big plans and a few changes in the works, but decided to open for Halloween. Pack your thermos with warm drinks, blankets, and snacks, because they will also be running on minimal staff, so not everything in the resto is functional and in full service. Well, this seemingly innocuous little post to inform people that there's something maybe kind of cool coming up over Halloween weekend, but it exploded, Kevin. I can't believe the number of comments and how this took on almost a life of its own, as things do sometimes on the internet. So We managed to reach out to a gentleman who actually is not part of the company that owns the place, but was hired to get it ready. His name is Anthony. He's from the OMG Cleaning Services. Anthony, welcome to the show. Thanks for agreeing to come on and talk to us. And I know that you might not know everything that's going on, but you know more than most of us. How are you?
I'm not so bad. Thanks for having me on, Lee.
Good. So that is your company, the OMG Cleaning Services, and your company was engaged to get the site ready, correct?
Right. Yes, because it had been sitting for the 2 years,
right?
Because it was for sale. So the transaction did happen, I would say about a month or so ago. It was bought by Premier Theaters. So they own all the drive-ins, like they got the 5 drive-in up in Oakville and other ones in around the GTA. So they bought it out. And they hired me on to come in and say, what can you do with this place? Because it's moldy. It's been sitting for 2 years. And so I put my crew together. We got all the mold out of the bathrooms. They're all ready to go. I mean, King Charles himself could eat in the bathroom now. And yeah, they're basically just, they wanted to pass a few things with the health board because the health board said, you know, this place is a disaster. So we went in, we got it all up to snuff. It's all clean, sanitized. And so as far as I know, they're going to be doing a massive renovation probably over the winter to really bring it up to their standards,
right?
Because it is very outdated. It's got all old electrical equipment, so they want to fix it to gas. But so that's why they're not really promoting that they're doing food. The only thing they said they would do is probably hot dogs, popcorn, bottled drinks.
Right.
Like, as you said, they are in a minimal staff. They didn't want to make this a big hoopla, and next, you know, they get overrun by people that they can't handle.
So, well, it kind of turned into a big hoopla all by itself, even though
it almost seems that way. I mean, I told them, I told a couple of friends, and you know, I got a couple of friends in weird places, and it kind of seemed like it spread a little bigger than we thought it would. And so I did let him know, and I even offered my hand and not looking for money, just saying, like, I may have told a few too many people. So if you need my help this weekend, you know, I'll be glad to do what I can. It is true. They are looking out.
You kind of addressed already one of the questions that I had not yet asked, but I'm going to back up. So the new owners, this is one of the things that had been bantied about on the internet by various comments, the fact that, who would pay $8 million or whatever? I don't know how much they paid for it. I don't really care. But you know how these stories take off. Who would pay that kind of money and not develop it, et cetera? So there are a lot of people that have been calling this fake news, the fact that, no, we're not going to be operating a drive-in theater. But you said at the beginning when you first started talking that it was purchased by a company that is already familiar with running film.
Yes.
Facilities.
Yes. So they, like I said, they own all the other ones up on the other side of the lake there. They got one out in Hamilton as well. So it's Premier Theater. So they know what they're doing. So I just deal with the general manager.
I find that kind of exciting. The fact that somebody that really is in the business knows the business that they bought.
Yes, absolutely. Because they can't do anything with the land. I mean, a lot of people aren't aware, but that is protected land. You can't do anything other than what it's got on it. So the housing market, you can't even touch that area. So what better than just leave it what it is?
So now, what do you make of the wildfire that was ignited by the post and all of the comments? And there were people that were actually putting some kind of hateful sounding things on there. How can a drive-in cause that much controversy?
Well, that's social media for you. I mean, everyone's obviously got their bravery when they're sitting behind their keyboards. But I mean, some people just like to fight for the sake of fighting, and good for them. If that's what the turns are cranked, then by all means, we're just out to spread the word.
So now that we know that it's not fake news, what days or nights is it going to be operating?
So they're just hoping to do, like I said, a Halloween theme, Friday, Saturday, Sunday night.
Okay.
And they're only operating two screens because a couple of the cameras aren't working properly. So as far as I know, the only titles I've heard that I remember is Smile and Halloween Ends. I can't remember the names of the other two that they're airing, but they are like legit, like up-to-date movies. There will be obviously an admission at the door to get in. It's your standard admission to get in the drive-in on a weekend. So be prepared to pay that price and just, yeah, snuggle up. It might be a little brisk this weekend, but you know, if you have to start the car, they are offering free boosts, as far as I remember.
So are those movies supposedly Halloween-style, as it said in the post, screen type movies? I didn't
quite... Yeah, it's not something you want to bring the kids to.
It's
probably a little gory. It's for the Halloween fanatics that are, obviously adults. They're not showing anything that's kid-friendly, as far as I know.
And, of course, they usually start, if I remember my drive-in vernacular, they start at dusk, whatever dusk is these days. I guess it's like 7:30.
7:30-ish, yeah.
Yeah.
Seems to be.
Yeah.
I mean, it's sunny now, so I wouldn't assume anything would start until after 8 o'clock if it was a night like or day like today.
Well, thank you for coming in to clear up the controversy, because I think there are probably a lot of people that are totally surprised that
yes,
this is actually going to happen, especially as you see it's been closed for a couple of years, and that venue for entertainment, that kind of venue, has been out of fashion rather for quite some time. I think it's still a really cool thing to do, and I'm glad it's not completely dead, because it was I have fond memories of going to the drive-in. You probably do too.
I do.
Yeah, I gotta say, Lee, I was most excited, Anthony, when you told me who had purchased it, and the fact that they're going to invest some money into it, which means we're going to have a drive-in movie theater here in Niagara for probably decades to come. That's awesome.
And that's what I like, that it wasn't purchased by somebody that wants to try to throw up an auto mall or something. The fact that we've actually got film operators, film venue operators, that purchased the property. And that, to me, is awesome. Before we let you go, what do you do? I mean, the OMG cleaning services, I mean, that kind of says it all, but tell us a little bit about your company.
Well, we've been operating in Niagara for about 10 years. We're basically Niagara's food bar cleaner. So we pride ourselves that we don't do dishes and laundry, pretty much. So anything you've got to throw at us, where we'll come and clean the exterior of your home. The interior, like we get it cleaned up to snuff, or say if you had a bad party one night and somebody destroyed your house, bad renters, anything, you name it, we do it. We can detail cars. We do commercial cleaning for washroom, or like in washrooms, kitchens, gas stations, like I said, you name it, we do it. But if you throw dishes and laundry at us, we're going to say no.
That's awesome. Now, one of the things that you alluded to earlier was the fact that everything had been cleaned and sanitized and all the rest of it, and the bathrooms were all good, and like you did a pro job. Has there been, because one of the people or two of the people or more on this plethora of Facebook posts talked about health inspections and things like that. To your knowledge, I can assume that they would have had these done.
I would bet my house that they will pass all health inspections.
Okay.
So we did a full massive overhaul of that place. So starting in the washrooms, I mean, we did a pure full acid wash of all the urinals, get all the mold and things that grows and over the time. Power wash all the walls, the toilets, everything was completely clean, sanitized. Same with the kitchen, all the equipment was all hot water washed with proper chemicals and detergents. All the contestant stands, so all throughout with all those shelving units and what have you, they got quite moldy with the over the past couple of years, but they're all cleaned out, disinfected, the whole nine yards. The floor was all machine scrubbed, cleaned up. Windows is all professionally cleaned, so it looks fairly new in there, other than maybe the ceiling looks a little rough, but other than that, it's clean, it's fresh, ready to go. There's
awesome.
No bugs, no spiders or anything in there.
It'll probably be the cleanest looking drive-in theater that any of us have ever seen.
More than likely. I'll put $10 on that.
Because I remember what they looked like back in the day.
Yeah, and then, you know, unfortunately, kids nowadays, they don't really like cleaning washrooms. So nice thing that they left it up to the professionals to get it done and ready to go this week.
Anthony from the OMG Cleaning Services, kind of putting a bow on this story for us. Thank you, man, for joining us. We appreciate your time. And if you're hanging around over there on the weekend, have fun.
I will do that. Thank you.
All right.
And
cheers.
Follow me on Instagram if you want to see some gross stuff.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
See ya.
Goodbye.
Well, there we go, Kevin. And that pretty much does put a bow on it. That confirms that, A, it is going to be operating in kind of a soft opening situation, but as you mentioned and as I said a couple of times, but it bears repeating, the CanView drive-in theater facility has been purchased by professional, experienced film and movie operator company, an entertainment company that operates facilities like this around the province, and that's really positive stuff. There we go.
I'm super stoked by that. I didn't know what was going to happen there. I was aware of at least the fact of where it's at, and you can't just develop houses everywhere, right? It has to be properly zoned and everything. So I knew houses weren't coming there, but I didn't know that somebody else would be investing in a drive-in movie theater.
But again, super cool. We have seen zoning bylaws change frequently over the years, so you never know. But yeah, anyway, I still don't think that's going to happen. I think what he said was truthful, and why would a movie operator buy a movie site and then change it from, you know?
Yeah, but it's so cool that it's opening this weekend, and wow, I mean, I think people online were perfectly split between this is happening and this is fake news. Mm-hmm. And you saw that in all the comments. So all we wanted to do was get somebody close to the source. And as Anthony mentioned there for the beginning, that he is kind of promoting this in lockstep with the owners.
Yeah.
It's a bit of a soft opening. But man, I mean, that one post got like 2,000 shares. So I don't know. It might be more of a hard opening for them this weekend. But
they might have more people than they bargained for. Anyway, that's the 360 view of the CanView drive-in story. Coming up in mere minutes is BrickinNick. Now, if you are a Lego aficionado, you may already know BrickinNick. He is one of the contestants on season 3 of Lego Masters, a show that has become incredibly popular. It airs Wednesdays at 9 p.m. on Fox Network. And BrickinNick is out of Toronto, and he's going to be joining us just to talk about the show. Now, I will warn you right up front. I am not a Lego master myself. Kevin Jack, our executive producer, whom you've already seen from WeeStreem, is more informed on this subject because he watches the show all the time. So I'm probably going to defer most of this interview to Kevin, because he's the guy that knows more about asking the questions than me. But we thought you might be interested in this because it's one of those shows that has, like food shows, like cooking shows or whatever, it's taken off and become something pretty special. And I know there are a lot of Lego people out there. Somebody we have on the show quite often, Scott Sutherland of the network, he's a big Lego guy, and there are more like him, maybe you, out there. So BrickinNick is coming up, and as soon as he clues in, then we will get him on and find out more about that.
Yeah, and Lee, just so you know, we got Nick in the green room, but let's run through our other guests, and then we'll circle back and bring Nick on.
Okay, we're going to have Dan Warkentin on. Dan Warkentin, you may remember, is a real estate agent in the Niagara region, and for charity for a number of years he has operated scavenger hunts Christmas time, Halloween time, etc. And it's that time again. Coming up on Sunday, there is going to be the Halloween candy capsule hunt, and to describe to us how that's going to work and how you can participate, Dan's going to come on somewhere around 12:45, 10:01, somewhere along there on the program. And we'll be talking with the guitarist and vocalist of a band called Road Waves. And G Sharp is the fellow's name. Very creative name. And they are starting after, you know, COVID and how it shut down an awful lot of live entertainment or almost all live entertainment in the last couple of years. Road Waves is back on the road, and we're going to be talking about that just before the end of the program, because they will be our musical guest to play us off the stage today. So without further ado, and again, thank you to Gales Gas Bars for being our title sponsor of this program. Verge Insurance Group, thank you also for supporting us, as you have done for quite some time now. And of course, WeeStreem powers this incredible technology called streaming at the highest level of quality. Kevin Jack, co-founder of WeeStreem and our executive producer, and we're going to bring on BrickinNick, which of course is his brand on the show. Do I call you Brickin or do I call you Nick?
Nick works for me.
Nick is good? Okay, Nick works for me too. So, obviously you are surrounded by some of your creations. Are you at home at the moment?
Yeah, I'm in my studio. This is where I normally do all of my live streaming and content creation for. So it is filled to the brim with Lego bricks for me to build with.
Yeah, so I see. Now, talk about a so-called children's toy, as it was dubbed many years ago. Lego has come a long way, baby, as they say.
Yeah, it definitely has. Even from when I was a kid and first building with Lego, Lego's evolved a lot. Some people look back on Lego and just remember the very basic kind of bricks that you would use to build. And Lego's evolved a lot since, in adding a lot of specialized pieces and stuff. But for someone like myself who loves to use Lego creatively, that really just continues to open more and more doors to allow a lot more creativity with the brick. And it allows you to build way more detailed and complex creations. And it leads, for me at least, to a lot more fun.
Now, many years ago, you're probably too young to remember this, but Ontario Place in Toronto had, you know, in the big golf ball there that they have, they had a whole floor in there almost at one time dedicated to Lego creations and things like that. Even that long ago, I found it fascinating.
Yeah, no, I do recall that existing. I don't think I ever got to go there.
Yeah.
But, like, I definitely remember hearing about it. So, I mean, it's certainly been a phenomena for a long time. And shows like Lego Masters have gone a long way to really help show people, you know, that Lego is for everybody and it's so much fun.
Now, speaking of that, that provides us with a good segue. You may have seen my intro, you may not have, but Kevin Jack, our executive producer, is very, very familiar with the show Lego Masters. I'm a little bit, but he is way more. So I thought I would probably defer to him to ask most of the questions about the show itself. Sure. So I'm going to just fly right over there and say, Kevin, jump in here and take us where you want with this gentleman.
Nick, first away, I love watching the episode last night. Your corgi was absolutely bang on. I think that was the best episode of Lego Masters yet, because it was just everything. It was fun. It was cute. It was all that. Your builds were awesome.
Yeah.
Season 3, first time Canadians were allowed on the show for the first couple of seasons, and with the internationals, were you a fan of the show? And then how did you get involved with actually becoming a contestant?
Yeah, I've definitely been a fan of the show from the moment I heard it was announced. The first season was actually in the UK, I believe, I want to say like 2018 or 2019. So it started quite some time ago now, but it's been going. And pretty much from the moment the show started, they had actually reached out to me. They do a lot of scouting for the show, and they, I think, heavily lean into Instagram as kind of a place to be able to find people. And of course, I've been slapping all of my Lego creations on Instagram for years and years and years now. Just trying to, you know, share my passion for building with the world. And so they caught on to that. So we've actually been talking for a couple of years now. And it just feels like, you know, kind of this year was kind of the right time for the pieces to fall into place, if you will, pun intended.
Pardon the pun.
For us to get on the show.
Okay, let me ask you a question about the show and the builds themselves. I think last night for the dogs, you were given 11 hours. Sometimes these builds are 14, 15, 16 hours. Is that all in one shot or is it over 2 days?
I feel like I'm not technically supposed to answer this, but I'm sure you can imagine that is not like done all at once, and that doesn't realistically fit into a, let's say, working schedule of a day, even if you consider, you know, what film and production might allow for. So
yeah.
You can kind of fill in the blank there yourself.
Who is the coolest person to meet so far? I mean, Will Arnett is just awesome. You also have the Brick Masters that are there, and then even Christopher Pratt showed up for a Jurassic Park theme. So what were you most starstruck by?
Honestly, I think all of it, like, to me, like, Amy and Jamie are, like, superstars in their own right. You know, they have kind of my childhood dream job of designing Lego sets. So getting to meet and hang out with them and, you know, have them judge our builds is honestly feels like a privilege and an honor. So definitely a little bit of starstruck with them. And then, yeah, just, like, literally meeting the voice behind Lego Batman and the voice behind Emmett from the Lego movie, you know, is also super-duper surreal. So it's really hard to put that, like, feeling into words because it's just totally surreal.
Okay, for those people that are not familiar with the program, this is a competition, is it not?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is.
Yes.
Exactly, yeah. So
and
this season with 12 teams, and we're slowly working our way down to find the Lego Masters.
Okay, 12 teams. How many people on a team?
2 people per team.
Okay, so who do you work with?
So my partner on the show is Stacey Roy. She is a fellow Canadian. We actually met and found each other through like live streaming Lego building. We both actually stream on Amazon, interestingly. And I had noticed she'd been doing a lot of Lego building on there over the last year or so. And so when I was trying to figure out who I would partner up with to audition for this season, I was like, okay, I need to find someone who has a similar career to me. So does like live streaming, a content creation, is also Canadian for some added points. And then of course likes Lego. And so I thought of Stacey, and we had never met in person before, but we had connected online. So I reached out and I said, hey, like, you know, I'm being reached out to about this show. Would you be interested in trying this out with me? And she was, and it ended up working out that we got on together.
Kevin, earlier, before we went to air, said to me probably the cutest show was last night because it was the puppy show, right?
Yes, so, the dog show.
So when they, whoever they are, assigns a project, mm-hmm. and How do you go about accomplishing that project? Do you have to go buy specific stuff, or do you use Lego that you have, or how do you go about building what you want to build?
Oh, are you talking about on the show or like on my own?
No,
on the show, we are on a set. There is what's called the brick pit, and it has over 5 million bricks that we have access to. So kind of similar to how you would see it on like a cooking show or a baking show, they have all the supplies there for you to use.
Okay.
And it's just a matter of you and your teammate, you know, working on coming up with an idea, figuring out a strategy, and then executing it over the time that you're given.
So okay. Let me ask you, Nick.
Yeah.
On the show, the builds are really elaborate, and you're not working from a kit. And so much of Lego building these days are kits.
Yeah.
So how much of what you're doing on the show is, I'll say, out of your comfort zone, or something that's new you've never done before for either yourself or Stacey?
So weirdly, I would say pretty much everything on the show is a little bit outside of my comfort zone, and that I've never really had access to that much Lego before. So building at these scales and with some of the added complexities of the challenges, like for the dog episode last night, we had to literally walk our dog down like a runway. So we had to ensure that the build was strong enough to actually be like dragged or rolled along the little carpet that they had. And that's just not something you would ever really anticipate having to do with Lego.
No.
So in those ways, it's a very much outside of the comfort zone. But for me, I do focus on creative building. So the majority of the Lego building that I do does not involve instructions. So a lot of the stuff that you see in the background here are custom builds that I've created with no instructions whatsoever. And I love the process of just figuring out like, okay, I want to build, you know, I don't know, let's say like Bob Ross. I have Bob Ross hanging in the background here. And so I'm like, okay, what pieces can I use to create that awesome like afro that he has? Get it, that nice beard, like his soft smile. Like, so it's just all trial and error and figuring out how those pieces can come together to make these things recognizable to
so
anyone.
It's basically freestyling.
Yes, absolutely. Lego. That is a perfect word for it. Freestyling. Yep.
And I got a bit of a behind-the-scenes question. How much camaraderie is there between the teams in helping them out? You can tell right away that people come to the show with varying skill levels, but I mm-hmm. see some of the people that are maybe towards the bottom and really pulling off some incredible builds. Are the other teams really lending some expertise?
I would say, like, as much as we can, it's very hard to not get caught up. Of course, it is, at the end of the day, a competition, so we are all competitors. But we did find we quickly became family as well, and that we did all want to see each other succeed and we want to support each other. But even with that, you're still like getting very lost in the building. So there were a lot of times like where teams were struggling with things or like running into big roadblocks. And had I known about it, I would have loved to be able to kind of hop in and like offer what help I could. but you're so caught up in your own build that you really can't pull yourself away, or you don't even notice that these things are happening because you're just so zoned out on what you're doing. So I definitely did try to hop around when I could, offer some suggestions, and we all did that for each other when we could.
That's great.
It's very, very hard finding that time.
Yeah. So, like, you never really want to throw a baseball into somebody else's build or anything like that.
No, definitely not. Definitely not. Yeah, we're all playing nice here.
Yeah, that's good.
Let me ask you about this. On episodes like the rodeo episode, mm-hmm. and I think they alluded to next week coming up on the pirate episode, again, Wednesday nights on Fox.
Yep. CTV, I want to throw out for our Canadians here. It is on CTV at 9 p.m. as well.
Thank you very much for that. And you're right, I was watching it on CTV last night.
Exactly.
Watching your creations get destroyed after you've worked on them for 8 or 12 hours, what does that feel like?
It's not the best feeling. What I will say does help, though, is that you typically know they're going to be destroyed before you build them. So you kind of go into the build not, like, thinking that you're going to get to hold on to this thing. Like, you're building it with the intent of hopefully it not getting destroyed. And for example, like the bull ride challenge, if you could last all 10 levels, your build would stay together. That would have been nice, but no team's build survived all 10 levels of the mechanical bull. So in a way, you brace yourself and prepare yourself for the loss of that build, even after all that work.
All
it
right,
is fun
so
watching it, right?
What,
so.
How does the elimination work? How many weeks does this go? How do they eliminate teams?
Yeah.
How does the actual competition work?
Absolutely. So at least based on like last season, it was 12 teams, and then pretty much every episode, one team would be eliminated. There's like a top two, so they kind of recognize some of the best builds from an episode, and then there's a bottom two, so they recognize the builds that were, you know, weak for whatever reason in that challenge. And then one of the bottom teams will be eliminated. They've mixed things up a little bit this season. Usually the first episode of the season, they don't eliminate someone. They did do that this season, so that was a bit of a change. And then at the end of the third episode, and this is a bit of a spoiler alert, but they did actually add in a new team out of nowhere. So
okay.
They've been throwing some curveballs into the mix. It is, at the end of the day, a reality show, and a lot of reality shows will add twists and turns like that. So
in essence, would I be wrong if I said that season three is actually already over for you?
Oh, and in a sense of that, it's all filmed already, absolutely.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
I know what happened as far as I went in the experience.
Yeah.
But,
and you can't talk
about
it, of course.
It's going to be a couple more weeks before everyone else knows exactly what went down, because we're currently on the fifth episode, and there should be about 12 episodes in total.
Okay, I gotta ask you this. You spend hours and hours and hours at this passion of yours, which mm-hmm. is terrific. Do you have a day job, or is this a career somehow for you?
So,
I mean, do mom and dad say, "Look, Nick, you're still playing with Lego?"
There was definitely that for a time, but I am very fortunate in that I have been able to move and make Lego building my full-time job to a degree.
Really?
I would say more so that content creation is my career. So, you know, I do some stuff with Amazon and other things that kind of all come together and allow me to do this full time. I do have a background, interestingly, in mechanical engineering. That's what I went to school and studied for.
Oh, okay.
So I did work in that for a little bit. And then I was just discovering that I was really enjoying being able to share my passion for building with the world through live streaming and, you know, YouTube videos and Instagram and whatever. And that slowly evolved into a thing that I could do full time. I worked retail as well a little bit part time while I was kind of getting that figured out, if you will. So I did have to, you know, ensure that I was consistently supporting myself through more normal means while I was figuring it out. But eventually I did get it to the point where I'm doing it full time. I'm almost about 2 years now of doing just the content creation.
Well, congratulations. Full-time. Find your passion and then find a way to make a dollar from it. That is that's terrific. Did you want to ask something else?
I got something I want to throw your way. Along those lines, where did you find, what platforms are the most profitable for you?
Twitch has definitely been one of my favorite places to create content, and it's certainly been one of the longest and most consistent for me. And then weirdly, again, like Amazon Live is a big part of what allows me to do content creation full time. It's not in Canada, so you'll never kind of come across it as a Canadian on Amazon.ca. It's only on Amazon.com. But essentially, like, I do live Lego building on there, and it gives me an opportunity to answer questions about the Lego sets that I'm building to someone who might be shopping for the sets that I'm building and such.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Did you have more?
Yeah, well, a friend of mine, a content creator, also from Ontario, has gotten more and more into Amazon. He says, yeah, the Canadian people don't get to see it, but for me, if I'm looking at it from a business point of view, that's a good place for me to be. So I'm always interested for, you know, it's interesting. You talk about that that arc of your life, and you know, your parents saying, well, why don't you get a real job, and you do have a real education, but at the same time, you know what, I can make this a living. And I think it's a generational thing where we have to accept the fact that this is a living. Like, I'm wholeheartedly behind it, but you know, people 10 years, 20 years older than you or myself are looking at this and going, so you do what? Explain to me again? But I got the utmost respect for that. Really cool.
Let me sort of mine your expertise here a little bit more for people that, again, like me, that know what Lego is, but we're not really participants in the current trend. As Kevin said, there are so many kits. There's like the CN Tower kit, and there's the Star Wars characters, and like all of those, the hundreds and hundreds of different builds that come as a kit. Mm-hmm. When someone you said you were in engineering, is it somebody like you that would build this thing first and then sort of send the kit as a deconstruct? How do they do that?
For me at least, how my process kind of works is that, like, yes, I do buy sets and sometimes I build them, but a lot of the time I will actually admittedly buy a set specifically for the individual pieces within it, knowing that I'm going to be able to use those pieces to help me bring my creative projects to life.
All right.
I do like to kind of build and explore sets, because honestly, a lot of the people who work at Lego and design those sets are people like me who love building creatively. So in a way, they're getting to do what I do their actual proper job.
So when they design them, they'll build it and then disassemble it and send it out.
So in a way, sort of. Yeah, that's kind of like a way that the process works. Yeah.
Yeah, I got a question for you here, Nick. For amateur builders, and our kids are 7 and 8 years old, and they love playing with Lego. I actually shared with you a photo. I'll throw it up in a bit. A photo of our Lego room at home.
Yeah, it's awesome.
When you watch the show, there's some advanced techniques, and also the use of technics is really important for the structure and strength of your build. What do you think is kind of the next step for amateur builders to incorporate so that they can get better at their builds?
Ooh, that's a really good one. I think something I've kind of discovered and figured out about Lego building in general is that it's almost like a good way to almost describe it is like resolution. So.
Just freeze.
A little freeze. We'll get him back.
But yeah, anyway, Wednesday nights. Last night was the Brickminster dog show. They all had to make full size replicas. Very simple,
but at the same time, you could recognize what it was, right? The picture wasn't complicated. It was made up of a couple of pixels, but you still understood what was going on. And so when you're going about creative building, I think a good way to start is to keep your builds to a very low resolution. Keep them very simple. Don't try to get over detailed, because the build will start to get confusing and people will get lost in it. And as you get better and better at building at a lower resolution, you can slowly increase that resolution and allow you to get more complicated. And as you do that, you can integrate more techniques, like using Technic bricks to help your builds be stronger and add more functionality to them.
What is a Technic brick?
Yeah, let me give you an idea here. Technic bricks are pieces that kind of would maybe more be associated with like kind of engineering or mechanical things. So they have holes and they have axles and they allow things to move and rotate and kind of like sit at different angles. Like these would be some Technic pieces too. So they give you a lot more flexibility and kind of how you can reinforce and add functionality and strength to your builds. So they are a core part of a lot of Lego building. But when you're starting out, I don't recommend trying to integrate these right away, because they can be a little bit more complex and confusing to integrate.
How fascinating would it be to climb inside the mind of people that design these Lego pieces?
Oh, yeah,
I mean,
for
my God, that's like genius level to the 10th degree to a design, because you've got to figure out how differently these things can work when you're like inventing one piece.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's amazing.
Yeah,
honestly, that's what I love most about it, is just figuring that all out and seeing how you can make it happen. And I think Lego is one of those things that surprises and delights me even all the time, and just finding all the different ways you can put those little bricks together.
Gosh, I mean, I could just talk forever and ever, but at some point we got to stop this thing short. But I just want to credit you in, I think it was episode 3 or what have you, when you had to do the tree houses. I thought the selection that you and Stacy did was brilliant from an overall. I mean, it not only did it, and I know you got a mini version right there. So there you go. They built that more life size. And, you know, you had lots of different things that you could choose. By choosing that build, you paid homage to Lego, but you also gave yourself so many different support points to help to help. And I'm just like, you know what? From the onset and from a design standpoint, that was a brilliant choice. And you guys actually won the episode.
What was the name of that build?
It was called the Treehouse Challenge. So they literally gave us actual trees, and we had to build around the tree and have like some sort of treehouse on there. So me and Stacy decided to build an actual Lego brick on the tree.
Okay, where do these judges come from? We're going to let you go in a minute, but we could keep you probably all afternoon. But where do the judges come from? Who are these people?
The judges are Amy and Jamie. They're called Brickmasters. That's kind of their judge title, and they're actually both designers at Lego. So they do that job where they design the kits that we love to build, that we love to buy and build and bring to life. So they are experts at Lego in the sense that they're the ones who are the brains behind the amazing kits that we love.
Would you ever want to do their job?
Absolutely. Unfortunately, you have to live in Denmark to do it, and I really like Canada, so.
Denmark?
Yes, Denmark is where Lego's originally from, so.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
We would have always assumed in our world that it would be the United States. Right?
Oh, come on. You got to shore up on your Lego history.
I told you. You're the expert, not me. Hey, I'm asking questions because I come from the pool of the ill-informed.
Well, I got to say, Nick, I'm really looking forward to next week with the pirate ships. Man, I could just go on and on and on and ask things behind the scenes, but that's for another day, I think.
Absolutely.
Yeah, sure. I did want to throw out quickly, I love that you mentioned Scott Sutherland. I've never met him, but we've actually connected through Twitter years ago.
Yeah.
And I know he's a big fan, and we like come across each other's stuff on socials all the time.
Yeah, he's a good friend. We've spent some interesting times together, and he is he's a Lego nut, so I'm sure he'll click onto this program, or you'll point him in our direction.
Oh, he already knows about it. Yeah, he's all in it. So,
all right, he's probably jealous that he can't come in and ask you questions.
Well, maybe we'll have to set that up sometime.
Yeah, maybe we will. Well, BrickinNick, I know you know the results, and we don't. So, but I'll be sort of stupid anyway, and wish you good luck on the rest of the season. It must be a little bit hard to bite your tongue and not talk to people about it, but that's the way of network television and how these reality shows work. So, congratulations on your success, and we'll chat again. When is the last episode on? When do we know how it turns out?
Admittedly, I don't exactly know. I think it'll be towards the end of the year, based on kind of just if you roughed it out right now. But,
oh, so they're really dragging it out.
We'll have to keep watching to find out.
So. Okay. All right, man. Thanks. A total pleasure. Thank you for being here.
No worries. Take care.
Fascinating people on this planet, Kevin.
First year they allowed Canadians on the show, and there were three teams of Canadians, including Nick and Stacy. Stacy out from British Columbia. We got a couple of firefighters from Calgary, and then I'm not exactly sure where in Canada the other pair are from. But cool to see the Canadians just absolutely inundated. Lego Masters Season 3.
Indeed. Want to thank once again our sponsors of this program, Gales Gas Bars Limited, for being our primary and title sponsor of Niagara 411 Live with Lee Sterry. They are a Rainbow registered company, which means that they are a safe haven for customers and staff alike, regardless of your sexual orientation, race, color, creed, etc., as well as a living wage employer in the region of Niagara, one of the first to do so here in Niagara. And I think you're probably pretty familiar with what that is. Basically, it's the powers that be, the financial powers that be, determine what a living wage actually is in whatever municipality we're in. And companies can choose to become a living wage employer by meeting those standards or exceeding them, as a matter of fact. And Gales Gas Bars does just that. So to Jessica Friesen and her gang, thank you for being leaders in the Niagara business community. Verge Insurance Group, Mark Shirk, Blake Shirk, and the rest of your staff, thank you for being here. And once again, this is a company that is made for and operated for and run by Niagarans. And that's very important to this program. Kevin Jack of WeeStreem, him and his partner Brandon Scram. Now, we've talked about this before. You were in year 6 headed to year 7?
Yeah, I think we might actually be in 7 headed to 8.
In 7 heading to 8.
Yeah, well, for example, I saw a company yesterday, you know, came across a new streaming company, and they said, oh, we're professionals in the field and blah, 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 launched in 2020. And, you know, and they're claiming to know everything about live streaming. I'm like, oh, I got some years on you. You got a lot to learn yet.
And I do want to mention the program that we did this past Monday, of course. That was Election 2022 here in Niagara. It was our Niagara 411 live election result coverage. I appreciate the positive feedback that we've received from all people that that watched the program, or a lot of people that watched the program. And once again, it was really energizing to be able to focus on election coverage from the ridings and the municipalities that mattered to Niagara, and do it quickly. That's just a bit of a sample of what it looked like on
not,
the show.
Not a good sample.
Not a good sample.
I was zoomed in there a little time.
But, and again, as we were talking about kind of off the top, turnout for the votes for the election, not good. Percentages somewhere in the 30% range across Ontario. Niagara on the Lake was probably the best performer in Niagara at Kevin, around 50%.
Yeah,
and down considerably from there. And as Kevin and I talked about before, I believe that the key, the absolute key, to unlock the door of poor voter turnout results is the internet. We're going to do online debates, we're going to do online competitions, we're going to do online voting, and if we have any hope in hell of engaging the younger voter in traditional politics, we have to think very untraditionally or non-traditionally. Because if we keep doing the same, it's like the definition of insanity. Doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. Well, that's not going to happen. If we keep doing the same thing over and over again, we will not get any different results. We will get diminishing returns as opposed to increasing returns. We have to take this process to the people in the way that they want to be communicated with. And I know I dangled a preposition at the end of that sentence, but we have to talk to people the way they want to be talked to.
Yep, couldn't agree more.
And we are not doing it. And WeeStreem, going forward, take note, political parties and candidates, is going to be one of those waves of the future, of getting the word out that you want to get out with a minimum of effort and a maximum of result.
Thank you so much for that, Lee.
I honestly believe it, Kevin.
Yeah, you're almost like you're taking the words out of my mouth, so I don't need to repeat it. Still to come on the show, we got G-Sharp and Roadways. They got a brand new music video out for a new single. And we're also going to talk to Dan Warkentin. I know you got the deer thing on the 406. Do you want to talk the deer thing, or do you want to get to the James Street shooting?
Well, I think the James Street shooting is very pivotal. Let's go there, because you got some interesting pictures of that, scary pictures actually. And when something violent hits close to home, I guess they say if it bleeds, it leads, and I hate that phrase, but this is sort of that way. St. Catharines detectives investigating an overnight shooting on James Street, which is like right there from us here at Feulled, responded to a barbershop located on James Street, but it's not an operating barbershop, Kevin. It was a closed shop. It was a closed store, a non-business location. Upon arrival, officers determined the window had been shot multiple times. Detectives assigned to the investigation have assumed carriage of it. They are being supported by members of the Forensic Services Unit. The business was unoccupied, as I said at the time, no injuries. Investigation has determined the shooting occurred at approximately 4:30 in the morning. Nothing good happens at 4:30 in the morning. Detectives have identified a suspect vehicle in the appeal and are appealing to members of the public for assistance. So it was kind of a newer model, late model sports SUV, maybe a Lexus. So, I mean, it wasn't a cheap ride. Red in color, four doors, of course. And upon CCTV footage review, etc., that's the main picture that was posted on Niagara 411 and around social media. But, Kevin, there were some other photographs that were
So throw them up here. These are from Fred Bowring. He's a man about town.
Yeah, we've known Fred for a
while. So he went
time.
On scene, and I'll tell you, the actual photos are a lot scarier than that.
Than that one.
Than the police report reads.
Yeah, because that doesn't really show the damage.
So here it is. That's the barbershop in question.
Like,
so
look at this.
It's across from the former L3. So people remember where L3 was for some years. Right across the road, or I guess next to the Scotiabank.
Right. Now,
it got ripped.
Why does someone in a late model SUV of some expense park outside an abandoned shop and blow its windows out? Was there something going on in that abandoned shop? Did someone own that abandoned shop that had perhaps taken a wrong turn with whoever it is that had the gun? I mean, there are a lot of questions.
And look how many bullets
there's
we're talking
still a plant here. In the window, Kevin.
Yeah, but look how many bullets we're talking
I know.
Really. Of the now Glass, I'm assuming it was Hourglass Barbershop. It's the Glass Burr Shop.
Hourglass Barbershop, yeah. Sorry, I'm laughing, but that is quite cute. But there you go. There had to be. Look at. I mean, they were blasting away at this place. Semi-automatic weapons, perhaps?
And those?
Because it doesn't. You don't sit there that long to take pot shots with a single shot gun or something.
I mean, that's a ton of bullets.
That's a lot of bullets. I wonder how many got embedded in the walls inside. Because there were enough outside.
That's crazy. And the NRP release doesn't really speak to this.
No.
I mean, this concerns me as a resident.
Me too.
Downtown, somebody, I mean,
That's some big time, that's some movie style drive-by shooting right there. And they didn't just drive by. They parked there and blasted away for a little bit. And we still don't get them. All right, so that's disturbing. So there's something going on with regard to that property. And I would love to pick the brain of investigating officers, but they would never talk to us anyway, because you know that they're thinking what we're thinking. Something's going on there. Could be a number of things. Lest I besmirch someone's reputation, I shall not go further. But you could come up with a whole pile of different scenarios that led to that. Dan Warkentin, real estate sales and investment. Dan Warkentin at royallepage.ca is where you can find him. And he has been a community charity supporter for quite some time now, using his network and using his community philanthropy sort of passion to help raise money for good causes. And I want to ask him this question when he comes on, but the next scavenger hunt, that has sort of become his bailiwick, is scavenger hunts for charity, and the next one is coming up on Sunday, the Halloween candy capsule hunt. Just a great way for families to work together and have some fun. So Dan, welcome back to the show. Good to have you here, pal.
Thanks for having me, Lee. Kevin, how are you guys doing today?
Great, thanks. How's life treating you?
I can't complain. Life's good. Life's good.
Good. So it wouldn't be proper of me if I didn't ask a real estate agent that's on the show of how this recent change in things like interest rates and quote unquote recession flags and all of this other stuff. How is the state of the Niagara region real estate market these days?
The market's definitely taken a change from what it was, say, a year ago. There's no competition. The prices have definitely dropped a lot. You know, that's due to a number of things. Inflation, interest rates rising, all kinds of things like that. So the competition that we were experiencing from out-of-town buyers and all that, that's almost all completely gone. You know, properties are still moving steadily, maybe not as much as they were a year ago or whatever. But they're moving steady. It's a great time for buyers. In my opinion, it's you might be paying a higher interest rate, but you can always change that in a couple of years when you refinance or whatever your situation may be. But, you know, you buy, it's just like the stock market, right? You buy low and inevitably it always goes high in the long run. If you're a long run buyer, I mean, if you're trying to liquidate something in 2 years or do something like that, this is not the time for that. But, you know, for the long run, definitely. I definitely see prices going up long run.
That's a good thing. And even as a homeowner, I mean, you'd like to think, wow, I could make a killing if I sell my house. But I think for Niagara, and not just Niagara, municipalities all over the province and across the country for that matter, if we can somehow make the conditions such that new buyers can get into the market, that's always a good thing for me, from my perspective anyway.
Very much so, very much so. Yeah. And I think right now, you know, prices are dropping quite a bit from what they were. There's no competition, so what you were seeing a year ago is if a place was listed for 500, it was selling for 6, 7 maybe even, mm-hmm. which is way above what it should be. A lot of the times the appraisals wouldn't come back and then you're stuck with that situation. It's just not a good situation to be in. At this time for buyers, it's a great time to go actually shopping and choose what you want. You know, you're not rushing into anything drastically because of the nature of the market. It's a lot more slow paced. It's a lot more comfortable for buyers. For sellers, it's just about having the right marketing and getting the word out there, and proper marketing really makes a difference on that.
Okay, Dan, let's move on to why we I took advantage of you because you were here by asking you the real estate stuff.
Hey, no problem.
tell us about the Halloween candy capsule hunt.
Candy capsule hunt. Yeah, so as you guys know, I've been doing this for a couple of years now. You guys helped spread the word tremendously, so I just want to thank you guys, first of all, for that.
You're welcome.
So I'll be doing it again this year. So this year, there will be a couple changes, though. So last year, the turnout was incredible. Everything was found within 35, 40 minutes. So I didn't even get a chance to put out all the hints. So this year, I'm going to make it a little harder. You're not going to get as many hints. I used to give 3 hints. I'm only giving 1 this year. And so basically, for anybody who doesn't know how it works, I'll be hiding 3 candy capsules stuffed to the brim in 3 of St. Catherine's parks, so 1 in each park. And at 12 p.m. sharp on my Facebook, I'll be giving the names of the parks in which they're located in. And I will only be giving 1 hint this year, so that hint will be at 1:30. So okay. Sunday, October 30th at 12 p.m., you'll know the names of the parks that they're hidden in. At 1:30, you'll get 1 hint. The rest is up to everybody else. You got to go find it. And you'll notice there's a code lock. There's always a code lock attached to my candy capsule. So when you find it, you take a picture or a selfie with you and your family in the candy capsule, post it on Facebook, tag me in the post, and you'll get your code to the treasure. Now, another thing that I added this year. So, you know, last year I just did the candy and everything, and I said I was going to step it up a little bit. So I've decided to put gift cards in each candy capsule for a local restaurant in the city, which the area you found it. So if you found it in the North End, there will be a local restaurant in the North End, which you will win a gift card for to take the family out for a meal or whatever.
Oh, terrific. Terrific. Yeah, great idea. Now, where do we find these hints? Where are you making this public?
This will all be on my Facebook. So Dan Warkentin on Facebook. I have everything set to public, so you can either add me, follow me, or just keep an eye on my Facebook. But at 12 p.m. sharp, I will name the parks that they're hidden in. And like I said, at 1:30 p.m., I will be giving 1 hint. The rest is up to everybody else to find, and that's that pretty much, yeah. And once you find it, like I said, tag me in the post. You get the code to your candy and your treasure, and that's that.
Is there any fee for participating in this?
Absolutely not. No, this is just something
just
for fun. I started it during COVID when I figured no kids were going to be trick-or-treating. I'm like, how can I get them some candy? So I started it as a joke thing, really, and it just turned into this, and you guys helped get the word out there tremendously. So I love doing it. Last year, I sat in the Port Dalhousie parking lot. I had one in Port Dalhousie, and I grabbed a tea from Tim Hortons, and I sat in the parking lot and kind of put my seat down, and I watched at least 4 families scavenging around for the candy, and then I ran out, and I said congratulations and all that.
What is it that there must be something genetic. There's got to be some switch or something that inspires people such as yourself to just give back for fun.
Absolutely.
And not profit. And so where do you get this gene? I mean, if everybody was like you, if all of us were like you and came up with something just to give back for nothing.
Yeah.
Like, how do you, How do you get inspired to do that?
The law of attraction. You know, if I personally am a firm believer, if you want to live a good life, if you want good things happening to you, then just do good things for others and help others get to where they need to be, and that'll get you to where you need to be. And I'm a firm believer in that. And not only that, it makes me feel good. You honestly do.
There
when you
go.
Do something good for people, you feel good. You get this sense of just happiness that comes upon you, and you're like, you know what, this is a good feeling. And the more you do it, you'll notice your quality of life. It just gets better, better, better. And it becomes more fun and more, you want to do more and bigger, right? Like, because of that feeling. So you get addicted to it in a sense, and it's good. You spread joy. That person maybe will feel the same way and, you know, continue the chain, hopefully.
Yeah. I think that's probably the key. Now, the cynics out there watching this conversation right now will say, well, he's doing that because it promotes him. He's an independent contractor, is a real estate agent, runs his own business. He's got the Royal LePage logo on it and everything else. He's doing it to generate business. Well, okay, that might be a residual effect. But
true.
You could still generate revenue by selling houses or properties or commercial areas without doing this.
100%. Like, you know, my advertisement and my business is steady. And to be honest with you, I have never gotten business from doing this. I actually used my name and my business as more of a way to promote this game instead of vice versa, right? So okay. I figured, okay, people kind of already know who I am. I can get the word out because I do a lot of advertising and stuff like that.
All
so
right.
I can use that crutch to promote this thing. And just like I said, do something good, and it makes me feel good. I get a good time out of it. And that's the main thing. Right?
All right, Dan, thank you very much for doing what you
thank
do,
you guys.
And welcome back to the show. I know you're going to probably have more fun than the searchers on
most Sunday. Likely. Yeah.
Halloween candy capsule hunt Sunday. This Sunday, 12 noon, it all starts. Dan Warkentin's Facebook page. You can just find him out there, and you'll figure out what's going on. Anything else we can help you with before we go? You're all good?
That's about it. Yeah, I appreciate you guys once again getting the word out there and helping it. And it's just, you know, it's a great thing for families to get out and have some fun.
Yeah.
And I'm sure I'll be seeing you guys around Christmas again for the toy drive, which I do with Home Hardware. So I'll be back again.
I have no doubt. Dan, thanks a lot. Have yourself a super weekend. Enjoy the hunt.
Thank you, guys. You as well. Take care.
Thanks, man. Bye.
Something, I think I'm going to go out.
Something inside these people makes them tick differently than the rest of us.
Oh, I love that, because it's like, what small little thing can I do to help improve the community? And during COVID, it's a perfect idea, and it was so successful. Hey, why not continue this on? And I know I'm going to be sitting here in 10 years with a 13th annual.
Yeah.
And it's just, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, it's nice to see nice people doing nice things.
Yeah, sure
really
is.
Really asking for nothing in return. I think that's really cool. Speaking of nice people, nice things, we've got that Good Samaritan story from the driver
yeah,
and the construction
that's
crew.
That's a good one.
You want to go to there?
Yeah, let's do that.
And then we're going to talk to G Sharp from Road Waves.
From Road Waves.
Five, 10 minutes.
Their promoter, a fellow that we've talked to, been in the music business in Canada for decades. Eric Alper, he is also an agent of musicians. He calls these Canada's Grateful Dead. I kind of enjoyed that comparison. Maybe we'll find out why. So this showed up on Niagara 411. Tyler Scram, who you know, Kevin, is that correct?
Yeah, for full disclosure, I've known Tyler and I've known his brother for probably 15, 20 years almost. I've known Tyler for a long time. And this showed up on Niagara 411.
Yeah, so Tyler says, I just want to take a moment to say thank you to Tony, never got his last name, who works for Brennan Paving, which I believe is under the Miller Group. That looked like a Miller construction truck that was parked there. Today I was left stranded on the Niagara southbound skyway. Okay, now, so picture that. You're on the southbound skyway heading from St. Catharines to Niagara Falls. Okay? Car had stalled and would only go 40 kilometers an hour once it started. Tony followed me over the skyway to the closed-off Glendale exit, which is a bone of contention with me, but that's another story. He had the construction site stop and open for me to drive through as he led with his four ways on. Had a second truck follow me through the site to city streets so I could safely access my car. Was a bad situation made better by being a good person lending a hand just because it was the right thing to do. So Tony, thank you again. Kevin, that is way above and beyond the call of duty. because it's one thing to help somebody on the side of the road that is in need, but entirely another thing to completely disrupt a construction process that's going on and allow a single motorist with a problem to pass through. Because let me tell you, if you're trying to get onto Glendale or do anything over there, and you're on the south side of the Skyway, you got to go to Mountain Road before you can possibly get your way back. You just can't get back. That's the quickest way, and that's a long way. So that's awesome. My husband works for Brennan. It really is a great company. Candace.
I'll get down to Candace.
Oh, that's all right. That's okay. Candace said, it's always amazing to hear of the good people in this world. I think we hear more about the negative and not enough about the positive. Kudos to Tony for being a good person and helping out, and to Tyler for acknowledging him. Of course, and that's one of the things that is nice about the site, that the Good Samaritans do step up. Same guys helped me out a few weeks back when my front tire popped. I was so scared at night on the side of the dark highway. They were literal angels. God bless you. That's amazing. I was coming over the Skyway, saw his truck with his lights on. Thanks for making him feel safe and getting off the highway safely. I had a truck pull over for me to check to see if I was okay. It was the last snowfall we had last year, and I spun out. He put himself in danger to get out of his truck and walked along the way, a highway. I was thankful. Just,
This is the same Tony who lives across the street from me.
Works yes.
For this company.
Mm-hmm. Love this. There are a lot
couple
of great
people identified him. Let's see if we can see where I know Tony was tagged.
Okay.
So at least thank the appropriate Tony. Hey, Tony.
How do we find him? Tony.
I felt like putting the a GIF up there from Tony from Seinfeld. There you go. Tony Shatler.
All right. We've identified the good. He probably doesn't want us to do that.
Good family man.
But yeah. Tony Shatler. That's the Tony. Well done, lad. Good for you. And
what a great story.
Yeah.
So what we wait
Boy,
for...
Boy, that's annoying having that ramp closed. Sorry, Kevin.
Oh, it is. No, what we wait for G-Sharp. Do you want to get to the deer story? Because I actually saw this last night.
Oh, let's do the deer story.
Let's see. I just got to pull it up.
There's sort of a couple of dimensions to this story, not just one story. Basically, what happened is the fact that on the 406, there was, as will happen from time to time, a confrontation between a deer and a car. Those are never good, because those deers are deer. Excuse me, not
I'm
deers.
Say, did you say deers?
I said deers. I'm sorry. Those deer, collective noun. Must remember, collective noun. Those deer are very powerful, very strong, very muscled animals, and even the smallest of deer is going to leave a mark if you have a confrontation with that in your vehicle. A lot of people have died as a result of such accidents, and many cars totaled because of coming in contact with an animal that big, even though some of the deer, as I said, are not that big. But there's the post, Highway 406 northbound, just north of Beaver Dams Road in Feulled, and you can imagine that because it's a pretty wide open space in that spot. Vehicle versus deer, emergency services responding. And Kevin, you said that you encountered the scene.
Yeah, I drove right by that last night. We were at bringing Alex to soccer down in Welland. So on the way home,
yeah.
I changed lanes because I saw just two cars were pulled over on the shoulder. So I'm like, well, I'll give them their space and I'll go into the left lane. Well, lucky I did, because there was a full deer splayed out just in the like right-hand lane.
Spread eagle on the...
Just done. I mean, obviously,
sad.
Got hit.
But
wasn't,
dangerous.
Yeah, and I was looking in my rear view because I knew somebody's going to hit that deer.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was, if you were riding in the right-hand lane, and if you get a string of traffic, well, let's say the first guy moves to the left lane, the second and third guy, at some point down the chain reaction, somebody's not going to have enough time to react.
And believe me, if you hit something like that in the road, it's...
You're going 100, 110.
It's going to hurt.
Yeah, like I was... But what was I to do as I passed? I mean, stopping
nothing,
to try and help
really
at that point.
Can
I can't do anything. There
point.
Were already a couple of people that were pulled over. So you could see here in the comments, Lee, is that some people were there. I mean, I saw the two cars at the side of the road. I mean, there's Sylvie right there.
Yeah. Just glad my family was not injured. Thank you to the gentleman who helped them. Deer are in rut season. You will see a lot more around this time of year. they're moving around a lot more and will increase with the temperature drop. This other fellow says, I invested in deer whistles for our vehicles and haven't had an issue. Of course, the only way for me to know they don't work would be to hit a deer.
That raises a really
That's
good question.
True.
Do you think those things work, the deer whistles?
Okay. I don't know. Now, Martin puts this up. Here's where the part two of the story goes. Martin says, they should move... God, I laughed when I saw this. They should move the deer crossing signs to roads with less traffic. Keep people on the highways safer. Don't know why they don't think of that. Now, to give Martin his due, he was joking. But a couple of people replied and said, you're a little bit touched, ain't you? And then he says, yeah, you bet I am. Oh, wait, you thought I was serious? Like deer can read and follow directions on signs? Oh, boy, that's touching. You would be surprised how many special people there are out there. Okay, now let's go to this little piece. We've got time to play this, right, Kev?
Yeah, we do.
All right. So this has gone around before, but someone also commenting on this story, on Niagara 411, posted this audio piece of an announcer at a talk radio station in the United States. And a woman, listener to the radio station, called in with a comment. And Tracy, standing loader, Tracy was able to remember this and posted a YouTube link to that conversation. And she says, that question reminds me of a lady calling a radio station to have the city move them. And I had to play this for you because it's just absolutely hilarious.
Now, Donna, you got quite the vent today. It sounds like what's going on with you.
Well, I wanted to voice my opinion on something that's been bothering me for a really long time.
Okay.
I tried writing the newspaper and contacting TV stations, but nobody seems to want to stay with this. So that's why I'm calling you guys.
Okay, what's the issue?
Well, over the past few years, I've been involved in three separate car accidents involving deer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with the population and everything. Each of these incidents, they've occurred shortly after I saw a deer crossing sign on the highway. Well, my frustration is that Minnesota and North Dakota Departments of Transportation would allow these deer crossings to be in such high traffic areas. I mean, I've even seen them on the interstate. Why are we encouraging deer to cross at the interstate? I don't get it. That's such a high traffic area. I mean,
you know,
I understand that deer are wild animals, and they need to travel across the streets occasionally to survive, and now, of course, to find food, but it seems to me that so irresponsible of us to allow these deer crossings to be in areas where these deer are so likely to be struck by oncoming traffic. I mean, wouldn't you agree? I mean, it's just, I mean, you think they would put deer crossings maybe, you know, in, you know, smaller towns, maybe during at a school crossing. It would be a safer place for them to cross.
Wait.
You know, put the deer crossing sign.
You know, deer crossings aren't telling deer that it's safe to cross there. It's just more of like an alert for drivers so they know it's like a high deer population.
The government put the deer crossings there. They can direct the deer population anywhere they want to by moving that deer crossing sign. I mean, you know, why in the world would they place it on the highway or the interstate? You know? I mean, God, there are so many other places I can think of than with the deer crossing signs on busy highways and interstates.
You seem to be under the misunderstanding that the deer are somehow attracted to the deer crossing sign.
Well, yeah, the deer crossing sign is there to allow the deer to know that's where they need to cross.
Right. And all these car accidents you had involved a deer after you saw a deer crossing sign.
Exactly. I mean, I'm trying to watch out for the deer, but, I mean, I'm, you know, speed limit's 55, 65. How am I supposed to, you know, you can't brake really quick if you, you know, if the deer just is crossing in that deer crossing area.
So you'd like to see these signs move somewhere safer?
Oh, God.
Right, yeah, if we can move them, like, don't put deer crossing signs on the interstate or freeways. No, put them in lower traffic areas.
Oh, my.
You know, somewhere where the speed limit's, you know, a lot slower, you know, maybe small towns, I don't know. I think school crossings is a good idea.
Well, listen, we will, yeah, I mean, you say you've tried to contact quite a few people about this.
Right, yeah, I wrote, like, at least 3 or 4 letters, and...
We will spread the word, okay? We will try to kind of help you raise some awareness for this issue, okay?
Oh, thank you. We need to move those deer crossing signs.
We appreciate your comment this morning.
All right, thanks.
That's a oh, my God, that is amazing. And you could tell these personalities that were doing this show were just doing their level best to not completely break down on the air. And how does that, but you could tell that was legitimate. I mean, that wasn't like Martin putting the joke up there. This woman actually believed that where the deer crossing signs were, the deer would cross there. If you move the sign, they're not gonna cross the road. Oh, Lordy. I had to play that, and obviously, as they mentioned through there, was in North Dakota, and I've driven through North Dakota and South Dakota, and yeah, there's a lot of areas where deer could cross the road.
They'd only move those signs. I don't know who's putting the signs by the busy highways.
Move
the interstates.
Damn sign.
Why would you want deer crossing here?
And the fact that the incidence of those accidents increases after the signs go up.
Crazy. Lee, I gotta go set up the outside camera.
All right.
But I'm gonna leave you with this one because this one's also a little head scratching.
Oh, sure, leave me with something.
Well, about the BMW that just slid into the Niagara River out in Chippewa yesterday.
We're waiting to hear from G Sharp of Road Waves. We haven't yet been able to come in contact with him. I still can't get that out of my mind. I'm sorry. But, yeah, this was... I don't know how this happens, but strange things do happen. This is a shot of Chippewa Dock in Niagara Falls with a vehicle off the road. Crews are on location now. Well, that was 19 hours ago. And then another picture. So how does... does somebody... Well... I guess they either make a miscue and lose control of the vehicle because they're not paying attention. They are impaired in some way or fell asleep. I mean, or had a health incident. I guess that would be the fourth option. If there was some sort of health incident that took place, that could do it. But that's a very, very strange place. If you know the area, for any vehicle to end up. But interesting pictures from Niagara 411. Keeping in mind, now that we're talking about Niagara 411, I want to acknowledge Nick and all the work that he does, continuing to work with us on this program, as well as put the information up, populate, that's what I was looking for, populate the Niagara 411 site with information that is of interest and importance to people in Niagara. And once again, one of the things that has been going on over the last little while with Facebook in general is really difficult to try to understand. A lot of you, I know, have been inconvenienced by all of a sudden Facebook just changing protocols in some way, shape, or form. Well, Niagara 411 has also been faced with that, and the fact that the community tab from the Niagara 411 Facebook page just one day was gone. And a lot of the information that would go up on the Niagara 411 site would pop up through that community tab. So Nick is still kind of do workarounds and trying to ensure the fact that the things that people want to have posted, irrespective of their focus, is actually accessible by people that are Niagara 411 followers. And Kevin, it's been a really interesting ride for you as well. We've, as you know, done this show now for quite some time. This is season three, and we're already into 40th episode of season three. And strange things happen all the time on social media, but Facebook in particular. As you know, or you may know, after we do this full show, which is always available for review, Kevin spends a lot of time and effort to take segments of the show that you might, if you can't sit and watch an entire hour and a half program, you can see segments of the program and watch those at your leisure, and they are posted there. We call them ICMY, in case you missed it. ICYMI, in case you missed it. Posts. And some weeks they work just fine and populate as they are supposed to. And then other weeks, nothing, honey. And there's no place you can go to complain. Like if you buy a sweater at the Bay and it doesn't fit, or there's something wrong with it, you can take it back. There is nobody at Facebook. Hello? Nobody's home. Nobody is home at Facebook. If you've got a problem dealing with Facebook, try and find somebody to talk to. Try to find somebody to send an email to. Nope. Hello? Nobody's home. So, we do...
Give me directly to Zuckerberg, please.
Yeah.
I've got an issue
with
my account.
Is Mark
there?
I've been flying. Mark who? And finally Zuckerberg.
I'm finally out of jail. Lee, I got out of jail. I was in jail.
That's good for you, Kevin.
30 days.
Are you on parole now? Or like?
I don't know. But I'll tell you, I was about to put a comment up the other day and realized that a word that I was using, that might get flagged, so I didn't put a comment up. So, Facebook has whipped me into shape. I'm hesitating with what I put up. Just to close the loop on one thing you were talking about, Lee, about the community page, it's now apparently the mentions tab. You can see it over there on the top on the right.
Oh, yeah.
You click on the mentions, and this is where we get a lot of the good community information. Like,
yeah,
here,
okay.
This guy here, 11:30 at night in Western Hill, he said there were two coyotes, and one of them was having dinner.
Ooh. And hope it wasn't somebody's pet.
October 23rd, 11:30 p.m. So what would that be? Monday, I think? Monday night.
Yeah.
So, really crazy stuff. Lee, we're going to wrap up the show. I'm going to throw an audible at you. Today, musically, we're going to hear from an artist known as VB, but you might remember her as Valerie Borghese.
Valerie Borghese. I've heard that name.
Yeah, absolutely. I think she opened the last time we had a big New Year's Eve celebration down in Queen Victoria Park. She was one of the opening acts.
Right.
I know, in addition to singing in bands and fronting bands, she's also taught a lot of people here.
VB?
And she's now going under the stage name, I guess, of VB, V-I-B-I.
Okay.
So Valerie Borghese is VB. And she has a song called Nights Like This with a video to coincide with it.
All right.
And she said that, the song itself is 3 or 4 or 5 years old, but finally just kind of put the finishing touches on it and got a video out there. So
cool.
Want to
cool.
share that with everyone.
Yeah, we'll look forward to that. And somewhere along the line, we were not able to connect with G Sharp of Road Waves, but hopefully we'll be able to do that in the not too distant future. Now, one of the things I did want to mention just before we get to VB is the fact that over the next few weeks, please watch Niagara 411 for alerts as to when we're going to be doing the program, because the month of November is starting to get a little bit complicated as far as work projects are concerned for both Lee Sterry Voice Services as well as WeeStreem. And so we'll be doing your show, but we'll be doing it perhaps on a different day. So just watch Niagara 411 and we'll alert you to when you might want to participate, all right? My name is Lee Sterry. Kevin Jack, thank you. It's always a pleasure to work with you. Job well done once again. Gales Gaspars, thank you for leading the sponsorships of this program. Verge Insurance Group, always a pleasure. And wow, that's a show that went fast. Anthony from the OMG Cleaning Services, thank you for being here to confirm that it is not fake news. Can View Open Air Drive-In Theaters will be open this weekend for some screening. Screen Movies, all right? And we'll keep you posted on how that company and how that business is evolving. BrickinNick, fascinating, fascinating conversation about his appearances on Season 3 of Lego Masters, appearing Wednesdays on Fox as well as airing on CTV. Dan Warkentin, all the best with your candy hunt, Halloween candy hunt. Coming up on Sunday. Everybody check him out starting at noon. And I guess that's just Fiddler's Poorhouse, as always. Dave McParian and his staff treat us extremely well here, and we're happy to be able to spend some time with you. Okay, I think I've done my duty. So we are now going to say so long. Thanks again for being here. Beautiful day in Niagara, and this is VB. Cheers.
I know I should reach out for help, but my pride tells me keep to myself. You ain't got problems. Tonight I was thinking of you and how little that you think about me. Now that's not the source of this feeling, but it's sure not the cure. 'Cause right now I should feel right on top of the world. I'm stuck in a city. Sleep.